I can feel the pollen in my eyes today. Good evening, everybody. This is the work session for the Board of Mayor and Aldermen for February 28th. Wow, last day in February. Let's call the roll, see who's here. Vice Mayor.
Here.
Alderman Blanton.
Here.
Alderman Hansen.
Here.
Alderman Peterson.
Here.
Alderman Berger.
Present.
Alderman Brown.
Present.
Alderman Potts.
Present.
And Alderman Baggett.
Present.
Okay, and the mayor's here too. So the first item on the agenda is an opportunity for citizens to make comments for items that are not on the agenda. And I have no speaker cards for that. So we'll continue to move on. We'll go to item number one, which is to deny sewer availability for 6 unaddressed properties, map 119 and parcel 00703, 704, 705, 707, 708, 709, and 1546 West Harpeth Road.
So this is an item that we had deferred from last meeting, because we'd had some questions and the property owner folks requesting this, I think, were not available. So we're bringing this to you. I think as we shared with you 2 weeks ago, this largely reflects the adjustments that are in process related to our urban growth boundaries. These are the very extreme southern portion of the growth boundary, and our current recommended adjustment is to actually remove these from our urban growth boundary because it's very difficult for us to serve at this time. So this has come through the Water Management Department, and we're bringing this to your attention so that we can respond to the request by property owners to deny. They had also made the request to be removed from the UGB earlier, so this is all consistent with dialogue you've had over the last year. But this is a formal request, and Michelle, you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, the only thing to add is that this is just a request for sewer denial. This is not a request for development, and there's been a little bit of jumbled conversations. We don't have any intentions of serving this property in the near future. This is about 2.5 miles away from our nearest infrastructure. So this is just a request for them to proceed without needing our availability.
Does this request also cover the urban growth boundary removal?
That will be handled through the growth plan update process that is still forthcoming. So we don't do that but through that process, but it's consistent with that action.
All right.
I do have a, go ahead, Alderman Hansen, and I do have a speaker who wanted to speak to this, Dana Frick, and so if she'd come on up and sit down up here, that'd be great.
So this is not going to move them out of Franklin and into Thompson Station?
Well, they're not in Franklin now. They're in our urban growth boundary.
Okay, but they're still technically using a Franklin, Tennessee address for mayor.
Yeah, well, lots of people do that.
Right.
But yeah. So, yeah, that would be to be determined whether they would be in Thompson Station down the line or not.
And the person requesting this, is this not a development group trying to develop homes on these properties? It's not an individual. It's a development group.
It is correct, yes.
Yeah. That's property correct. Owners, yeah.
And there's going to be quite a number of homes on it, is what I understand.
I can't confirm exactly where that is. It's not in our process.
I just feel like we need to know more information before we go and treat it as something simple as denying the permits for them so they can do what they want. I think we need to know more information. We need to know what they're doing with it. We also need to understand that taking an address out of a Franklin, what's technically a Franklin mailing address now, and moving it into a different city is going to affect their property values too. So there's a lot going on here instead of just, denying sewer availability to somebody, there's a lot of repercussions we need to think through. And I think there's a lot of moving parts, and I was on some emails today that led to a lot of other conversation on this.
Go ahead, Ms. Frick. We'd love to hear from you. A couple of minutes, please.
All right. Thank you. I'm Dana Frick, and I moved here to live near Franklin. Very proud of Franklin, very proud of Williamson County and their thoughtful development. I've been trying to follow this request from West Harpeth Ranch from A1 Home Builders, and it's been kind of confusing because it started out as a request for about 34 acres for 6 tracts, where they said, you know, is this okay with you if we provide sewer? And then it expands to 150. The intent on the file I read was for 150 single homes. But then for Williamson County Planning, they're showing 37 homes. And so I feel like A1 Builders may not be giving a clear message of their intent. And the surrounding residents have really strongly said to me that they want to stay as close to Franklin as possible. They don't want to be moved into the Thompson Station. They want Franklin to oversee them long term. If we were going to be in anyone's city, we'd rather be in Franklin. And so that's what we're concerned with, is by starting this, denied a request sewer from Franklin, they would then align with Thompson Station. They would then be in the city of Thompson Station. And that's not something that we're in favor of, and we want to be able to make sure that that's heard. So thank you for letting me speak.
Board members?
Yeah.
Alderman, Vice Mayor?
You're not being governed by the city of Franklin now. That's not.
Correct. We're unincorporated right now, right. And I understand that. But I also understand that long term, they want to look at doing some redesigning of the urban growth boundaries. And if we as residents of this area have a say, we don't want to be included in a Thompson Station urban growth boundary.
And do you have to be in Thompson Station to be in the county and get county approval from the county commission, county planning commission, in order to develop this piece of property?
Well, that's a very good question.
Is a very good question, because I don't think you do. So you're not going to, that property is not necessarily going to be annexed into Thompson Station. It'll be developed under the county planning commission regulations. I don't know what they are necessarily. I guess they probably adjust every once in a while on those, but I'm failing to understand just exactly. I understand what you think you want, but we're not going to run sewer to that particular location. And once we adjust our urban growth boundaries, it's a very good possibility that's going to come out of our urban growth boundaries.
And if it does, it does. But I would like some transparency for people that live in the area as why we're coming to voice our concerns about the activities.
And in reference to whether or not you have a Frank mailing address or what, I won't. If I'm not mistaken, you can go to Franklin mailing address and go to Mobley's Cut out to Boston if you want to. I think it used to be Route 6. I don't know where it is now. But that Franklin mailing address does not signify a great deal. It's Leaper's Fork. It's other areas. So, and there may have been something changed in the last several years, but that doesn't. Not having a Franklin mailing address, you would probably still have a Franklin mailing address on that, because it's not going to change the post office or anything, I don't think. That's just, so anyway, Will.
Eric, you got anything? I just want to clarify a couple things. And Mrs. Frick, are you in one of these properties, or are you adjacent to one of these properties?
In Indian Meadows, it's adjacent to one
okay.
of these properties.
And I don't believe your area is proposed to come out of the urban growth boundary.
They're not discussing us, but the adjacent
okay.
area does
okay.
impact us.
All right. I just want to make sure that that's clear. There's not any concern that you're being removed. I don't believe that is. But this is an area that is consistent with the direction you gave us previously as a board.
Mm-hmm.
So if you want to reconsider that, please let us know, because we've been moving along with those discussions. I mean, this isn't a huge shift, but it is one that was requested and that the board directed us to do. And this is, once you're removed from the UGB, this is what happens? It starts to look for other ways that it might develop. And so just give us that guidance if you want to revisit that issue. To this point, that has not seemed to be an issue that you've wanted to look at, but if there's a difference in how you want to approach that, let us know, because that process, I think, is going to start to move forward through the balance of this year. And we want to make sure our maps and our discussion is reflective of your direction.
Alderman Brown?
Yeah, I was a proponent of pulling it out. We have a lot of infrastructure needs and a lot of growth closer to us at this point. We're not going to reach this area. We're not going to be able to annex property if the owner doesn't want to be annexed anyway. To me, this, they want to be out. We should let them out. We're not going to get sewer there anyway. Denying sewer availability is just, reality is we can't get it there anyway. And for all that we need to do, our efforts are needed in a lot of other places where we can reach. So that's my two.
Is anyone here from A1? I think somebody helped me. Seemed like to me, I thought A1 wanted to stay within Franklin's urban growth boundary. It was my recollection on an email that I read. So, okay, we'll continue to move on and.
Thank you.
So,
did we give you?
This is
you
up get an tonight, answer? Right?
You're going to vote on this tonight.
This is up tonight.
Or decide whether you want to vote on this tonight. So we just kept it on because it had been a request. It was originally going to be on a Capital Investment Committee meeting that got canceled, and so we're just trying to keep things moving. So it's up to you if you're comfortable to vote on it tonight, or if you want more information or follow up.
Is it more than one reading?
It is not.
This is just the sewer denial.
This is just denying the sewer availability. It is not changing your urban growth boundary. That happens through the other process, but it's consistent with that action.
If you,
Mayor, we denied sewer availability across the street too, didn't we? In between Goose Creek and that big open green, I'm fairly certain we did that a few months ago.
Yeah, we had
the church.
Well, the church, and then there was that large property that
300 acres,
yeah, mm-hmm.
OT property, what I've always called.
I feel like that's kind of in the same line, you know, or I mean, it's in the same area. Mm-hmm. This would be further north than even that.
Yeah, denial doesn't necessarily mean you're removing it from the urban growth.
Understood.
But it is consistent with that direction as well.
What do you understand the number of homes that they're asking for? Because the information that I looked at said 37 on 100 and something acres. So,
well, in the letter, the file from Franklin, it said that the intent of A1 home builders is 150 homes on 150 acres. And that's part of my frustration, is the numbers change depending on who they're talking to. And so it would be helpful, I think, if we understood from A1 home builders, what is your intent for this property, and what happens if you don't deny sewer? How does that impact them? How does that impact their plans?
Go ahead, Alderman Peterson.
Well, you know, we were saying that, in fact, it was mentioned this morning that basically in the county, it's basically 5 acres mm-hmm. for a lot. Mm-hmm. And so if they're just going to stay in the county, I don't see how they could have 150 homes. Yeah.
Well, perhaps we need the applicant here to better understand. Mm-hmm.
Maybe we just defer until the applicant
can come in and we can get some clarification so we have a better understanding.
Yeah, that's, we can work to get them here.
Okay. Item two. Thank you, Ms. Frick.
I'm sorry. Will this be a topic at 7 o'clock today, or this will be deferred?
It's on the agenda. So. They'll get to decide what they want to do with it.
Okay, thank
you.
Yeah. Item two is Amendment 1 to the City of Franklin Contract 2022-0217 with C&T Engineering for Wastewater Reclamation Facility Liquid Maintenance for an amount not to exceed $31,200.
So this is an amendment to a previous contract that was approved to the Capital Investment Committee. This is just to continue the liquids maintenance. For those of y'all that weren't familiar, we've not been able to fill the maintenance tech position that we've had advertised for several years now. The good news is we have a potential applicant, so we're moving in the right direction, but we just need to kind of get us to that point. So I envision this being the last amendment that we'll need to do potentially before we have this other applicant on board.
Everybody good?
Any questions?
Item three is Economic Consultants Retail Recommendations Initial Elevation Studies for the city, new City Hall.
So as our team is coming up here to talk about this, this is the next step in our process with the City Hall project. Just as you know, we're moving in a kind of a parallel track related to what development at this site might look like, and understanding that, as well as integration of retail, a retail component in that project, as well as continuing to do some work at looking at comparative information for alternative sites in and around the downtown area. So this is really that work. We had an initial discussion with historic zoning. We'll reflect on that some and just give you some chance for feedback. And this is at the 25% stage of schematic design. So we're still pretty early, and this is part of that process of developing that concept, gaining feedback from you, from historic zoning, and continue to work through this option. So Vernon, I know, has some opening comments to help reflect that.
Yes, thank you, Eric, Mayor, and Alderman. Excited to have Anna Ruth and Matt here to share with you the 25% of the schematic design. But before I do that, I just want to add a little bit of context that I think we believe will be valuable to you. And first of all, as you've directed, staff is working on a hypothetical analysis for those alternative sites. That includes obtaining two independent appraisals for this property. We intend to bring that to you around early April, shortly, maybe late April, when it's time to present the 50% schematic design. And that's where you've given us direction to get to that point, and we'll be looking for feedback, whether to proceed on or look at the alternative sites, or maybe you'll want more information. But tonight we're focused on the retail component and to receive some guidance on how we proceed with including space within this building, as well as on the 25% schematic design, which is in your packet and we'll talk through. I want to share the most important piece, because we know our time is limited at these meetings, that should, and hopefully you will, have comments that you want to share, please email them to myself, Eric, and Kelly, and we'll make sure Anna Ruth, Matt, and their team get them, because we're going to keep proceeding to get to that 50% stage. But before we proceed with the recommendation, and presenting those initial elevations, I want to take a moment to talk about the roles of BOMA and the Historic Zoning Commission. Ultimately, and understandably, BOMA is the owner and client of this important project. And all development projects in our city go through a review and approval process. Our City Hall site is zoned downtown district and is within our historic preservation overlay, as we know. This means that for this site, the Franklin Planning Commission is tasked with reviewing and approving the site plan in accordance with our zoning ordinance and development regulations. And the Historic Zoning Commission is tasked with reviewing the site and building elevations to ensure that it meets the historic district guidelines. Then they have to do that before issuing a certificate of appropriateness. The Board of Mayor and Aldermen makes the decision to approve the overall project. We understand that, and whether to proceed forward to the Historic Zoning and Franklin Planning Commission for their respective approvals. Our goal, the consultant and the city staff, is to ensure that the proposal meets the zoning ordinance, our development guidelines, and the historic zoning design guidelines as it moves through the process, so it aligns with your expectations. This tandem approach is why we have periodically brought information to the Design Review Committee, which provides informal feedback prior to the formal submittal to the Historic Zoning Commission, which will come at a later date, hopefully later this year. Staff has worked with the Design Review Committee along the way, including a site walk during the visioning phase, a session on building form, scale, and massing, and precedent imagery, which has been included in our conversation interactions with the Planning Commission and yourselves at joint conceptual workshops. Last Monday, the initial preliminary concept was taken to the DRC for feedback. These initial elevations, which are in the presentation tonight, are at 25% complete stage. Please note that these initial elevations look like more than 25%. And it's because Anna Ruth, Matt, and their team have gone above and beyond to make sure you all have the information you need to provide meaningful feedback. They have done it from the start, and they can do it, continue to do it to this date. The City Hall scope of work includes feedback sessions again. Today's 25, 50% in a couple months, 75, and 100% if you allow us to proceed forward. There are several takeaways from the DRC meeting, if you hadn't been able to observe it. Some of the comments include elegant, magnificent, fits well, massing and scale are appropriate, Third Avenue massing and setbacks done well, courtyard cutout is attractive and helps with the scale. Last Monday afternoon, the DRC also made several good points on the architectural details, which Anna Ruth and Matt have heeded, such as the columns and porticos and building entry, but overall like the brick and stone materials. The detailing will continue to evolve in this process as it is set out to be. Design work is naturally an interim process. Although the elevations appear to be further along at this point, the aldermen can see the 3D renderings in color and hopefully provide us the feedback that we need to move the project forward to 50% design. In historic towns and cities across the country, I know I'm stating the obvious, there are special places where consideration of change warrants the highest level of scrutiny. Downtown Franklin and our historic public, excuse me, historic public square is one of those places. This is one reason why the early DRC reviews and regular check-ins with BOMA are so important. The consultant and staff want to make sure that the end design is one that we all can be proud of and that represents the city and fits in with the context of our historic public square. With that, I turn it over to Anna Ruth and Matt to share Bob Gibbs' recommendations for the retail space and also to share the 25% designs.
Thank you, Vernon, and thank you all for coming this afternoon to talk to us about the retail studies and the elevations. I do want to take a second just to reiterate a little bit of what Vernon said, because I think it's important that you hear it from us, that we are very early in the design process here. There are several phases of design, and we're at 25% of the first phase. The most important thing is that we're here to do this, to solicit your feedback, to get your comments, and we develop this design together. As I don't need to tell any of you, there's a lot of opinions as things move from abstract to more real, and no. Rarely do they all agree with each other. So we're here to listen once we share these ideas. We want your feedback. We're going to come back and do it again and again and again until we all get something that we're happy with. So I ask that you keep that in mind, because some of these do look a little more finished or final, and we're not here to tell you that this is the elevation. I hope you like it. Okay? So with that, I'm going to move into the incorporation of 4,500 square foot retail into the project. To reorient you to what we've discussed previously, this slide shows the proposed site plan with the City Hall building here. I have my remote pointer. along with a park feature on the corner of Church Street and 3rd Avenue South. We've reviewed the proposed site plan accompanying building elevations with Bob Gibbs, the economic consultant, to gain his feedback and recommendations on the most successful implementation of a retail use within the overall scope of the project. And we've implemented these into this site plan. We're also showing the potential for a public restroom building here to support the park activities and provide public access to restrooms at this end of the site. So the retail there, we're circling the retail just to make sure you can see where it is and how big 4,500 square feet is relative to the overall site. Bob recommends that the food service use that complements and interacts with the park as the highest and best retail use. A 4,500 square foot single tenant is similar to a standalone chain restaurant that would require surface parking and not complement the park or the fabric of historic downtown Franklin. The market analyst recommendation is for 2 to 3 smaller restaurant tenants with 40 to 50 seats each, since healthy competition between multiple tenants is preferable to a single tenant. These restaurants would be destinations that complement the park with outdoor seating. Mr. Gibbs gave the team recommendations on the process moving forward, in which city leaders would work closely with the surrounding property owners, stakeholders, and citizens to set a clear purpose for the commercial lease space. This would then be used as the basis for an RFQ that would procure third-party management firms. Next, we'll share the initial elevation studies for the City Hall. Once again, remember, 25% schematic design, and we anticipate a lot of rounds of refinement prior to arriving at the final elevations. This is a view as we see this corner of City Hall on the square now. We've taken these shots from the same perspectives to help you compare the height, massing, and scale of the overall feel of the new City Hall design compared to the existing conditions. As you can see, this view is taken from the main corner of City Hall facing Public Square and 3rd Avenue South. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Anna Ruth to walk you through the elevations.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so this is the proposed preliminary design taken from the same viewpoint. Okay. Okay. Can you hear me better? Sort of. As close to it as I can get. Okay. This is the proposed preliminary design taken from the same viewpoint as that view on the previous slide. So the goal of the design is to complete the square. So we're going to be aligning this front wall with the front wall of the courthouse to complete the geometry of this quadrant of the square. We're proposing a raised plaza on the square that wraps around to 3rd Avenue. And as you can see, the proposed materiality of the building is predominantly brick with limestone accents and a limestone cornice. This view is a good view of the 3rd Avenue massing. You can see that courtyard that was mentioned previously from the DRC feedback. It helps break down the scale and massing of this elevation and provides a break before the building steps down to 2 stories, which relates better to the massing and scale of the residential and civic structures further down 3rd Avenue.
And we're using abbreviations that our audience may not fully appreciate. DRC is the Design Review Committee of the Historic Zoning Commission. So they are giving us feedback from that context.
Okay, thank you, Eric.
Thanks.
I don't know why this isn't working.
I do want to say, in reality, though, putting trees right next to the parking, well, we found out that on Main Street, that doesn't work because the trees, you know, grow up and have to be taken out and things
like
that.
We've adjusted the types of trees we use on Main Street.
I know,
so that
but still,
be part of it too.
But still, and I don't. I assume that there's still parking on both sides.
Yes, and a drop-off zone. Okay.
Question before you move on.
Uh-huh.
Sorry.
It's okay.
So both of these look like entrances. Is mm-hmm. there going to be a 3rd Avenue entrance?
So
and a square entrance?
That's a good observation and something that the Design Review Committee raised with us as well. What we were trying to do is flank this corner, since the corner is so important, and we couldn't really get a corner entrance to work with the plan we needed with
the
lobby.
That was my next question, because that was one of the things I thought would be really cool if it was like situated on the corner.
Right, and we didn't want to mimic the other corners either. We have the rounded element on the 231 building and then the canted corner diagonally across the square. So we really felt like the entry needed to face Public Square and really have that civic presence versus canning it to the corner. So that was the reasoning behind that. But we have heard that from different people.
I'd love to see it both ways. I want it on the corner.
Sure. And there was a lot of strong feedback about maintaining that civic edge in the alignment with the courthouse, that breaking the corner with a chamfer or a rounded corner starts to break down that relationship and lose where the wall planes align. But
all that sounds very lofty, and I don't understand what you're saying. Good for you,
so that's why we did it, but we're, as I said, we're here to take that feedback. So okay. Thank you.
And then to address the 2 entries, you are correct. The main entrance is facing the public square. The other portico is outside the boardroom. We have double height windows to give you some daylight
in a boardroom. And that portico, since it's western light and you're going to be in here in the afternoons, it's meant to shade the windows and to give some shading. So, but we did hear that that's confusing and could be conflicting entry points, especially since you have an entry on 3rd Avenue now. So that's something we're going to look at when we go back to the drawing board.
Thank you. I didn't mean to get stuck, but while we were there.
No, no. Good question.
Mm-hmm.
Vice Mayor?
Are you just proceeding along as if there's no chance that that building's not going to be on this location?
That is our direction, to proceed with 50%.
We're going in parallel. This is exactly right. What we described. You go in parallel to 50%.
But if you're going in parallel, that design there might not necessarily work at a different location,
correct,
would it?
No, because we're
okay,
very site-driven.
So it's not parallel.
But, well, this, the exterior definitely reflects this site and this location.
Okay.
The operation of the building and the program has been established before we started the elevation, and a lot of that will carry forward because the staff still needs to work the same way.
But another site could have regulations that doesn't allow, sure, a three-story building, and mm-hmm, at this point our given is a three-story, mm-hmm, portion of the building. So we have to proceed with that given, or, you know, we can't just do a one-story version, a two-story version, a three-story version for whatever fits
the
site.
So whereabouts in this big, long process do we get to the point where there is no return? There is no option other than this location?
I address that.
Because that's, you know, mm-hmm, I thought we were looking at some different locations with Vernon. We give them a half mile radius,
yeah,
of the square to look at. You know, that was my understanding of where we were. Now, if we can run along with this right here and this just plops down into a different location, but I can look at that and tell you that that doesn't work that way. And, you know, and so, you know, I'm looking, if the board wants this, there's eight of us sitting up here. One of us has said pretty much that I don't believe it's necessary to have the city hall at this location. I've never said anything much different from that. I've said that you can go someplace else, and there's someplace else out near Columbia Avenue, and it's $10,500,000 less off the top because you don't need an underground garage and you don't need a location for the city employees at $2.5 million for 3 years. Now, what we've done here is gotten into this, and there might be no turning back at this location now. If it's no turning back,
Let me clarify this. It's not a no turning back situation. It's exactly what we talked about, which is getting to 50% schematic on this site and what that would look like, while we also have a framework to understand what a different site would look like and the different cost comparisons that are around downtown within that radius that we talked about. So those two are happening, and really where your decision point comes is when we have got to that 50% design to understand this site, and we've gotten more information both in terms of the value of this site and how it might compare to these other alternatives in downtown, because there's more than one potential downtown option.
Yeah.
So it's trying to understand all those, and I think at that 50% component, which Vernon described as probably somewhere around April or so, it is the point at which we're going to need that direction on it, how much further we go with one option or the other, what that looks like. So that's the plan, is to really work through and better understand this site through, this is a checkpoint related to that, while we also develop a framework to understand other sites as well. And then that gives you something to make a decision or give direction or ask more questions or whatever that might be.
But what we've got here is every dime that we've spent on this has been into this particular project right here. I'm saying that if you want to look at something else, there should be two drawings up there right now. If we're saying you're looking for another location or I'm looking for another location, I want to know how much it is. And it could be more than $10.5 million less. I need to understand, or somebody needs to understand, maybe I don't understand, maybe that's what it is, how you can go along with this right here and get to 50% and then come along and say, that doesn't work, we want to go to a different location, and we're now at 50% schematics that do not work at a different location. So that's what I'm asking.
Before I recognize Alderman Berger, Let me comment. You mentioned Columbia Avenue. We have other properties that have already
attracted. Yeah, I agree with that.
Well, we have other properties that have contacted us that want to be part of that process also, and that's why Mr. Girth and his team are working on what that would look like as far as bringing some to the board. So I'm not at liberty to say what those properties are at this point in time.
Well, one of them came to a meeting and made an offer, so.
Yeah.
So that would not a mystery.
That's not a liberty.
Some of them.
Yeah.
I want to make sure that we understand the schematic design is just that. We're in the schematic design phase. After the schematic design phase, if you allow us to get to 100%, which will be towards the end of the year, then we'll come back with an agreement to get into the construction drawings. And that's the high level of detail, that making sure that the interior functionality of the building will match the exterior and everything that comes along. This is, as we've tried to express, and one of the reasons why I shared my opening comments, we're only at 25%. We're scratching the surface of the exterior of this building and site. And another couple months, as we had brought up, is minuscule in a project where today the anticipated move-in date, if we were to stay on this site, would be in the spring of 2027. So that time is valuable that we keep stepping through. And then again, as April, as Eric mentioned, in April, we'll be looking for some decisions.
Yeah, and we're not planning to go past 50% till you tell us to do that. But this is a process that we've been that we ask you for that direction, and we're following through on that while we work on the other options as well, so we can have a framework to give us direction.
Look,
and we know what your direction is. We're looking on what the whole
board said. I voted to go to the 25% schematic and fund that.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't vote against that. I understand that.
Right.
But I don't see how you can pull up 50% schematics in the drawings that you've got with that in the background of possibly not even having that location at this, that building at this location, that confuses me.
Well, each design process is going to ultimately have to be tailored to the site you've selected.
Exactly.
So you have one site option that's been specific, you've done master planning around. Sure, elements of that might translate to another site, but we're trying to understand this site, and that's the direction the board gave us to go to 50% so we could better understand this site. Well, you also look at those other options. If you start to hone in on another site through that process, there'll have to be some specific work related to that site. So this is all part of that process.
You voted.
I'm sorry.
And I think we're following your direction.
I'll take Alderman Berger, then I'll take Alderman Baggett.
I'm just going to say, yes, exactly what you just said. And, you know, we have asked you to go ahead with this. I have no problem with this because we need to see 25, we need to see 50% because we have no other, we don't have an idea right now if any of these other sites are even going to work. And to stop dead in the tracks is stopping everything. It's going to put us way behind. I want this. I think we voted to go ahead with this. I know we did. And I need to see this. I need to see what you've got. I need to see how this looks on the square. I need to get some ideas because when other sites come up, every site is going to be different. No one building is going to go on any site you get. Everything is going to be different. But we are here and we're putting our efforts into this to really take a good look because this is where we are right now. This is where a lot of people through the years have all said, in multiple different boards that have sat up here on this dais, have said they wanted to keep City Hall square. I was one of the ones that said, I think we ought to at least give it some due diligence to say, is it plausible? Is it realistic? Is it smart? Even if it costs $5 more million or $6 or $8 more million to stay on the square, we have to say, is it worth it? Do we want that? Why do we want that? So what you're giving us here is tailored to the site. We need to see this. And if we're looking at other sites and we have no idea what this rendition is going to look like, no idea what 20 or 50% of the scale looks like, then I don't have anything to judge it on.
In all due respect to our presenters, I'd like for us to continue to move on. And
sorry,
Alderman Baggett, do you have a quick comment before?
Couldn't have said it better myself, Mayor.
Look, what you
what you said. We voted on this to go to 50%, and we've spent 10 minutes where I got a lot to say about this design, and we voted on this.
Please proceed. Anna Ruth.
Okay, so the second view we're going to look at is from further back. So this is
the vehicular entrance from Main Street into the square, as you know. And then, so this is the view of the preliminary design from the same perspective. Viewing it from this far back allows you to see the height in relationship to the courthouse better. And you can see that the height is pretty much to the midpoint of the courthouse roof. And again, you can see the Third Avenue massing. You can see the courtyard break and the step down to the two stories further down Third Avenue. And then this is the existing view from across the square of the existing City Hall building. The same view of the proposed design. The value of this view is to see the amount of the City Hall elevation as perceived from across the square. The remainder of this elevation is hidden from view by the 231 Public Square building. It's the portion of the building that's along the promenade to the Second Avenue parking garage. We've also included 2D elevations to help illustrate the preliminary design in relation to the existing context. So this slide has the two views of the public square elevation. The top one is the full elevation, inclusive of the pedestrian promenade portion, the portion of the building along the promenade to the Second Avenue garage. This is that tower of the Second Avenue garage. And then you can see the portion of the City Hall building that's perceived from across the square, similar to that perspective view that we viewed on the previous slide. And this is the Third Avenue 2D elevation. This portion, the third story portion of City Hall, is set back about 100 feet from the Third Avenue face of the elevation. And then that courtyard break that we've been talking about is in line with the pedestrian promenade behind the courthouse. And then it steps down to the two-story structure, and this actually houses IT on the first floor and fire administration on the second floor. So beyond this corner, if you can see my cursor, beyond this end corner of City Hall, we're either going to have the proposed retail, the potential retail with the park on the corner of 3rd and Church, or we'll have a larger park that extends all the way to City Hall if it's decided, if the direction is not to do the retail. So this elevation is the same elevation on 3rd Avenue with the proposed retail added on to the end of the City Hall, and then the park would be south of this plant, to the right of this drawing. We're going to continue to work with Bob Gibbs through all stages of design for successful implementation of this retail. But as you've seen from the feedback, he does feel like the retail in conjunction with the park would be a success because it's destination retail. So that's really everything we had to share. We're looking forward to additional thoughts and questions. So thank you again for your time.
Alderman Berger, will you finish with your comments before I go to Alderman Baggett?
Yep.
And then I've got Alderman Brown after that. And I'd like for us to be, and then Alderman Potts, I'd like for us to be conscious about the time, but I want everybody to have an opportunity to weigh in and make some comments. So.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Well, I think great job. You got a lot, I like you guys. No, not uh-oh. I think generally, and listen, I watched the DRC. Also have gotten feedback from those members when they were, you know, throughout the last week. And, just to be frank, like, I think what we have vetted and gone through together to 100%, let's say, I think the way the layout is, I think the way the park and this retail thing works together, the massing, like the stuff we've gotten to 100% on, I'm so glad to hear that there's no issues with that, right? So it gives me hope and gives me that we're going to get there on the 100% with the design. I did see the examples that you showed at DRC of some of the images that they selected, and yes, there's brick and there's some stone, but I think some of the detail, and I hear now tonight that that's the next 75%. So I think the details are going to be really important on this because this is a government building, and, you know, I've talked to some historic zoning commissioners, and when we build We're the city government building a building that traditionally we preserve those buildings. Like, those are the buildings that are preserved. We're preserving this house, this courthouse next door, 100 and 200 years, however old it is. And I think that the desire is that we are building something that in 100 years people are going to say, that design and detail, man, that's special. And I know you know that, but I think we have some work to do. And I never, maybe because we were on the board, we didn't get to pick the pictures to go with, and so maybe there's a disconnect there. But I don't know if everyone else. So, like, I think, too, that's where I feel like, hey, we can, maybe there was a missing element where we say, oh, yeah, option A or B, pictures, you know, that we like. Not that we can't go back to and do that, but maybe on this next 50%. I don't want us to get too far down the line in this 50%, and then, man, we really just don't like. We know it looks good, but it's just not it, you know.
Sure.
Wanting to avoid that.
Sometimes it's helpful to have case study images that show some of those details because a drawing doesn't communicate the same as a photograph, and it helps make the leap for imagining things before it's real. So we can look at accompanying some of those kinds of elements that show those details.
The Birmingham City Hall on the DRC, I mean, that had, you see that too? That was the character on that. Again, I think maybe letting us give some of that feedback in this next 25% phase, so we're not really having to backtrack. If we get to the second thing, last thing, is that the retail, I love it. I think the residents that I've talked to love it. It's just small enough. It's just big enough. I think it makes that corner very nice. I would be interested to see that maybe if that design could be even maybe different from the civic portion of the building, from materials or obviously, but it makes it kind of stand out and different. But yeah. I love if we're going to build a city hall here, I think the residents are going to expect that we just don't leave a whole corner open and green, like just a flat grass. Like, we need to program this. I think the citizens would expect that. Thank you, Mayor.
Alderman Brown.
Well, I may be in a bit different place here. I'll say two things. One is I keep trying to make this building smaller, and it keeps getting bigger. And to be honest, I'm going back to what's the problem we are trying to solve with the retail. And I understood it as three things. One, help in some way with the cost associated with building this building. Two, to activate Third Avenue. And three, which I thought was probably the most important thing, which is creating some energy and some mixed usage within our city hall. Get energy in here, get people coming in here and enjoying this. When I look at a retail space that is outside, it looks like we've basically done, here's this, here's this, here's this. Versus saying, how do we want our community to interact with our city, all of us together? Like, it doesn't need to be so compartmentalized. I feel like with this space sort of off to the side over here, we've sort of said, well, okay, well, here's your retail, and it's kind of this box over here. It's not even really fronted up. It's not integrated within. It's adding square footage, not actually helping to defer square footage. So now I don't know what the square footage of this whole space is now, but we surely got to be well above what I was comfortable with from the beginning. And I also thought that this park, I thought the whole idea was that someday maybe we did need more space and that we were going to be able to build on that parking structure underneath over that park. Well, now we're sticking a building in there. So I can only assume we either got to build around the building or we got to tear the building down to build a new spot. So it just seems incredibly counter to me. Like, it's just not lining up to me with what I thought the problem we were trying to solve with retail and creating this really great space where our citizens and our staff and all of us could interact and be together. I'm the architect. I don't know how it was supposed to look, but I really thought that the Third Avenue stretch here was going to be fronted with some retail and restaurants. It was going to be more internal to the building. This is just not at all what I thought we were going to be seeing. So.
No, we've already programmed the internal of the building.
I understand we had programming, but relative to how that programming fit within the structural design stuff, I'll be honest with you, I knew we needed so many desks and so many rooms, I get that, but I didn't take that as any kind of design until we actually started looking at how we would integrate something like a retail. We were still not even sure we were going to do retail.
But I mean,
I'm saying it could be right on the outside, on the front. Again, I'm no architect. I don't know how it fits in the building. I'm just saying all it seems like we've done now is just stick another building on the backside of this thing, which may or may not even work within our long-term plans.
So if I can respond to that, part of the feedback from the economic consultant was the retail goes best with the park. And putting it next to the park, having the opportunity for outdoor seating, activating that park, because like you said, you don't want it just a flat green space with no activity. And the retail is going to activate that, not City Hall. So you have that issue too to deal with, is just this one big lawn. And if City Hall came up to there, I understand the retail all along Third, but he also had concerns with combining the City Hall use and retail and how that would hurt the retail's success as well.
The final comment I make is just, I get we're trying to activate the retail. I thought we were doing the retail to help activate City Hall. We're spending a lot of money on a building for City Hall.
That was,
I'm just trying to make sure that we are creating the energy and the engagement that we really want. Setting this building apart separately just feels counter to that. Again, just my two cents on what I'm...
And that's helpful. I mean, I'm not sure we understood that as being such a primary goal, because the City Hall functions have been programmed in how the staff and department and efficiencies will operate and support each other and allow for security, allow for, you know, everything that goes with City Hall. The retail is still an option that hasn't been fully accepted, and so we're either designing two different City Halls if we incorporate it, and potentially how are we maintaining security and activity and noise to support City Hall functions with that, and we can study that, and I know we can solve it, but that's going to take a bigger commitment to put the retail in City Hall. And so while I say, like we did before, we have a lot of suggestions and opinions and ideas, we need direction, because we're here to work for you guys and do this together. Well, I think that we're...
Well, along Third, that would be in the floor plate of City Hall right now.
We have heard from people if it's going to be there, should it be within the envelope of City Hall in front Third Avenue, so that now we have a civic face on the square and a retail face potentially on Third Avenue. Block, yeah. That has not been the direction that came out of the first 2 years of this project. We can do it, but we need direction.
That was the floor spans of the parking garage. Because we talked about, you can't just go out 10 more feet or back 10
That's
more
right.
feet, because the structure of the garage and the support of the building, because I remember us thinking that, mm-hmm. and then I remember we got into this corner that, oh, well, then you'd have to expand the whole building
mm-hmm.
for the structure reasons, and then that was, you know, because I remember we were talking about that, but then structurally you'd have to build X, I can't remember how many square feet more. It was like 13,000.
Or we do a different structure that's a lot more expensive, but we're all conscious of cost and not trying to do that.
From a square footage standpoint, the size is consistent.
The size of City Hall is the exact same size that you approved with a 4,500 square foot retail.
It's 91,250 square feet for City Hall, 4,500 square foot of retail is what you're seeing on this plan. No.
We don't have 4,500 square feet to give up on the City Hall function without some harder decisions.
Well, and the 4,500 financial model was based on the square footage of City Hall being 91,250 and the budget of City Hall being based on that, is my understanding. Is that's how the 4,500
with the financing of what you can do relative to retail as part of this project. So there's a lot of complicated jigsaw puzzle pieces mm-hmm. to this.
Alderman Potts, I've been trying to recognize you.
Sorry.
Go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Matt, Anna Ruth, thank you for going above and beyond to get us 25%. I really appreciate that. taking all these questions. Circling back to it. I do agree with Alderman Baggett. As we move forward in this process, I really believe that this community requires us to have that 100-year vision of mm-hmm. this building mm-hmm. for design and detail combined with the character of our community.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that we're going to get there. We're only at 25% now. We will get there. My question, and Anna Ruth, if you could take us to slide 5 for just a second. This is something that I don't know that we've discussed before. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And this is on the promenade to the garage. Mm-hmm. As you said, we've widened the sidewalk there. It was what, and we're proposing what?
It's 18 feet now. We're going to 33.
Okay. So 18 to 33. And when we do that, if we're looking at this image right here, my concern is now we've opened ourselves up to the parking garage. And so has there been any discussion about how we, if you will, hide the parking garage or conceal that corner? Could you speak to that?
Yes, there is a lot of plans for landscaping in front of that that are not indicated in this rendering, like some more greenscape in front of that tower element, because we agree on our sidewalk, actually in phase one, we walked, you know, from the courthouse across Third and did not want that axial connection to that tower. So we're trying to put some kind of landscape element, but we haven't gotten there that far in the,
excellent.
But it's
and again,
on the
I know
brain.
We're at 25%,
right.
But I want to make sure that that is on our radar, because now we're opening that up to everybody's
right.
vision as they're walking and
right.
enjoying
and
the
we're
square.
Hoping this promenade is going to be interactive and more active because it is wider and have more landscaping to detract from the destination of the parking garage.
And also promote more safety by being more open and visible, so you have eyes on that promenade for late night meetings, you know, especially in the winter when it gets dark early, that it's a safer path to where most of the parking is.
And mine's less on the promenade. Mm-hmm. Mine is, how do you hide the garage?
Sure. And we admittedly are showing you where the architecture has developed really on two prominent faces, and the landscape has not been modeled and developed to that same point just yet.
Okay,
so.
Thank you.
You can. The site plan sort of shows that. We do have a tree right in front of the tower at the moment.
So. Alderman Hanson, go ahead.
So I'm agreeing a lot with what Matt Brown said with Alderman Brown on the retail. And it can be incorporated within the building because it's not inside the building. It's actually on the exterior of the building. It looks like you are double decking the retail, and that is a deal killer and a mission to fail for any kind of retail or restaurant to be on a second level.
Can you explain double decking?
You've got ground level and then you have
no,
second level.
We do not.
You
we do not. It's double height space to have that volume that retail needs. It has the windows up above because this could be potential expansion space for City Hall, and we're keeping that in mind, so we could build a floor on the second floor and connect straight into
so
City
it's only
Hall.
Single level.
It's only
at this
single
point.
Level.
I
double
would still
height
like
space.
To see some of it wrap around onto Third because we're going to still have a dead space, and we really want to activate that sidewalk. So if we could push at least one of those units onto Third, so we have some activity and kind of a cohesiveness between that. And then I've noticed during several of your conversations, you've talked about safety. Is there something we need to know about? Like, have there been some incidents with leaving in the evenings?
Yeah, one of the things we've highlighted throughout the process is to balance public access and the public nature of the building, but also provide for safety. It's just a good component of any public building.
It just makes it sound like we've had some activity or
no,
some
it's,
incidents.
No, it's just part of what you do when
I've
you plan a public building.
I've never felt safe leaving
yeah,
here
yeah.
ever, but it's come up a few times, so I just didn't know if there was something.
Obviously, there have been incidents across the country that you see in public
okay.
buildings from time to time, and it's just good planning to anticipate what are the right safety measures to incorporate while we balance it with openness and the public nature of the building.
Well,
so
that,
it's
yeah.
that's always been one of our top, whatever the top eight components that we've been working through, and that's one of the elements.
Okay. And our security consultant has projected the safety, you know, the escalation of danger around this area as the population grows. So we're looking forward into the future and how it could change over time, and making sure that, you know, we're not trying to add it later and it's built into the building.
Overall,
and also in a
design.
Right, in a manner that's not making it look like a fortress, but doing natural things to open it up to promote safe environments without looking like we've created a fortress and need armed guards everywhere.
Sure.
Yeah,
so, yeah,
especially as a 100-year building.
Move
you
the
mean.
Retail around, and I don't see, honestly, in most respects, why this could not almost be a portable building. Should we go to another location? When you look down immediate Columbia, the newer office buildings that were built, just as you pull down Columbia, kind of a similar, they're new buildings, but they have a more historic look. And if you were to go in an infill closer into downtown, I mean, it would be the same thing with just a moderate adjustment to the facade and elevation. I can see it being a very portable building, but it's lovely, it's visually appealing, and at 25%, it's still really exciting.
I've got Alderman Peterson.
Oh, sure. I just want to say that I am still very much interested in finding out about some other potential locations.
Appreciate that comment, but we're trying to focus on this tonight, if we would.
No, but again, if you notice on the comments that you sent to us, it was saying, it had another paragraph saying, we are still looking at those others.
Right.
And so I think that needs to be said.
All right, I want to keep moving.
I want to ask just one. The last time we had a meeting, I asked for something that's give me the square footage for every department currently. And the new square footage in this, the new building. I never got that.
We'll make sure you get that.
And if anybody else?
Everybody will get that information.
No.
Are you done?
Give it to everybody.
Are you finished?
I just have one quick thing. Retail, I don't think retail activates City Hall. I mean, it can, but you're going to have it on the outside. But it helps very, very much for what everyone's been telling us. We need more retail. We need more restaurants downtown. People are saying we need to activate our downtown a little bit more. And we've got more residents coming in downtown now, too. So I think that is not necessary here to just reactivate or activate more City Hall. I think it's actually the opposite. I don't think it can be hidden inside City Hall. I think it has to be prominent on there. And I think you need to ask Bob Gibbs to weigh in on that, how that looks, because it wouldn't hurt to have just a little bit different looking facade on that area that doesn't say this is, you know, City Hall, but you don't want it to look too different because it needs to blend in with this building. And the parking garage doesn't bother me because it's brick, looks good. It's not ugly concrete, but, you know, trees help. And then pushing the retail around the corner could kill that retail that's around the corner because it's hidden. We've always had problems off the square. What they've told us for years, that when you get off one block from Main Street, that's where actually it stops. So we don't want to put things around the corner, anybody. A little bit more on that, that would be hard. That's
Mr. Ravner, you wanted to make a two-minute comment.
Good evening. How are you? So Bob Ravener, 221 3rd Avenue South, also president of Downtown Neighborhood Association. One, to helpfully advance the line of thinking, we've got a survey going out as well with the location questions. But on the elevation, also anecdotally, and I'm glad to hear that we're in the early stages of getting feedback, but some of the feedback that we've received, while there's a lot to like about where we are in this process, thinking about this as a 100-year decision and thinking about it as something our grandchildren's children will look at, you want it to be able to say, that's historic and that was a great decision. Today, the anecdotes and the adjectives we're hearing are much more like commercial, overwhelming, and imposing, and really just want and appreciate that there's going to be more feedback along the way and would encourage more additional public feedback so that we get to that right choice, that when people look at this 100 years from now, they're going to say that was a great decision because it maintains our historic character.
Thank you. Ready to go to four? Item four, ordinance 2022-47, ordinance to amend ordinance 2022-03, amending Title 16 for public gathering expression events. I think Eric wants to set the stage for this. Here's my plan. I want to go down the row and ask each person what they want in this ordinance. We've been talking about it a long time. There's some choices that you can make. So I ask you to indicate what your choices are there. So be prepared after Eric, Chief Faulkner, and Shauna speak. I do have a few public comments. I'm going to limit the public comment period time on this particular item. So let's go.
All right. Thank you very much. Want to give an overview, and then I want to have Chief Faulkner speak to the broader topic and benefit of the public gathering and expression guidance that we've had to this point. We appreciate the feedback and the discussion we've had over the last three meetings. Want to bring back to you a specific recommendation from staff based on that dialogue, feedback we've gotten, our own review, and I'll hit the highlights of that, and then I want to step back and give Chief Faulkner an opportunity to speak about this as well, because you've heard Sean and I speak on elements of it over the last several meetings. But overall, the staff recommendation is to adjust this ordinance as drafted based on your feedback tonight, hopefully. And that would include a repeal of the action that was taken in August, the 2022-03 action. Repeal that. But by the same token, there's probably about four or five items that we would like to still address. And that's, I think, what the mayor's getting at, that I think still makes sense to address in some form or fashion. Some of it is a little bit of a cleanup. Some of it is maybe a different way to approach this that may help us. And then you've got the amplification issue, which is an issue that needs to be addressed beyond the whole public expression, because we've got a very old component of our ordinance, several decades, I think, dates back, that may not apply to how things are working in downtown today and may be helpful related to public expression, but also just day-to-day activity that doesn't require any permit, but maybe gets rid of what might technically require a permit today. So that has some ramifications beyond just this component. Before I go through those details, and there's probably five items that I'd like to ask you to address in conjunction with the repeal, is to just step back a little bit and talk about why we do this. And this has been an ordinance that was in place for about 3 years and really was helpful for us in managing some significant public expression events, and did them in ways that facilitated the expression but made sure we also provided for the safety of those involved in the expression, but also the general public. And so that has been our desire, to really facilitate public expression, but also provide a communication mechanism that helped us understand the event so that we could provide the safety and anticipate the impact of the event on our community. And we saw that work many, many times in the last 3 years. So I don't wanna throw the baby out with the bathwater, if you will, related to something I think that has worked well. There are elements in what we amended in August that have not worked as well, and so we're trying to address that thoughtfully and effectively. So I want to step back a little bit and give Chief a chance to talk about this. The police department has been an integral partner in the initial development of this and the review that we've done since then as well. So I want Chief Faulkner to speak a little bit from her perspective.
Thank you, Mr. Stuckey, and good evening. I'm usually not this dressed up. I have an officer getting an award later this evening, so I'm in. If that's helpful, yes. Thank you, ma'am. I appreciate it. I don't have to tell you all that public safety is the Franklin Police Department's priority, and it's our mission. Last year, Franklin officers responded to over 81,000 incidents. I don't know whether people think that we just sort of sit around that beautiful building on Columbia and wait for a call, but that's not how it happens. Officers are out on constant patrol. This was 17,000 more calls than the previous year, so our calls continue to go up. They also worked 43 planned special events and 476 posts. Now, in 2020, during the pandemic, officers answered 76,000 calls for service and covered 2,361 extra duty and event details. This amounted to over 11,000 hours of extra work and 700 more than the previous year in 2019, which was pre-pandemic. I'm sure you all remember that time. There was a lot going on throughout the nation, also in Nashville and in Franklin. There were demonstrations, marches, and other group gatherings. It's important to note, I think, that our resident population is about 83,000 individuals. But our transient and workers and guests and people who are here can elevate our population to about 100,000 people. We are a growing city. The police department not only works to keep order and safety during a demonstration or a gathering, but also answers calls for service and patrols the rest of the 42 square miles. the entire city needs is a police department. Now, I should also point out that, like every other law enforcement agency in the United States, we have police officer vacancies. It is imperative that I know what's going on in our city so that I can ensure staffing coverage, and more importantly to me, are my officer's safety. Now, here's what I would compare all of this. I've thought about this a lot, this whole discussion, and I get these every day. If you attend any event, a wedding, a dinner, a family event, a baby or a wedding shower, a groundbreaking ceremony, a grand opening of a business, a fundraiser for a nonprofit, a board meeting, an interview process for a job, even this meeting, in order to establish a quorum, you RSVP the host so that they can prepare ahead of time. The city of Franklin is the host of public spaces, and if you want to use them, we need to know about it. It's just that simple to me. Using public space requires some preparation ahead of time, and the city wants to ensure another group hasn't already requested the same space. We request the name and contact information for the leader or the organizer, the date, time, location, number of attendees. If they note it, they usually know how many people they've invited, or they can see how many people on their social media have shared and liked it and that they might intend to attend. They might also want to let us know, and we need to know, such things as lighting, amplification, parking places that need to be blocked due to the size of the crowd, if side streets need to be blocked to assist with pedestrian safety. We have all seen events in this country where people have targeted groups and gone right through and run over people. I'm not going to have that. So it helps us to know what they anticipate. If known, whether it's possible that there could be an opposing group also attending, and we've had groups tell us that there are people on their social media who are indicating that they're going to attend and be disruptive. If the opposing group has requested the same space, they would be offered a separate location, or we'd turn them away. We had that happen last summer, where another group showed up when someone else had a permit to use the space, and we've just flat told them, you don't have a permit, you're not coming. Often, I have to muster extra officers to work in order to have full coverage for both the group gathering and calls for service. This requires overtime, but we do what we need to do to protect our city. I've also requested assistance from the Williamson County Sheriff's Office, and they have from me, from some events that have occurred in their jurisdiction. For smaller groups, it would help us to know that they're going to show up, if possible. What's going to go on in case we get a call. Sometimes people see groups gathering and they get nervous and they call the police and say, hey, what's going on over there? And it helps us to be able to explain, oh, that's a group. We know about them. They're here just for this. It's okay. We know about it. And then it relieves people's concern. Again, we just want to make sure that someone else hasn't reserved the same space. The Franklin Police Department has worked very hard to keep the city safe. We have never arrested or cited anyone for public expression. With all of this craziness that's been going on the last few years, during the pandemic, we never cited anyone or arrested anyone. Everyone who wears the badge that I'm wearing tonight has raised their right hand and taken an oath of office to support the Constitution of the United States. At the end of this oath, each officer says, so help me God, and we mean it. We take this discussion seriously. However, we are simply doing what we have been sworn to do, and that's to keep public spaces safe and open to everyone. And I appreciate your interest in listening to me.
Thank you, Chief. Let me walk through the specifics. Again, the recommended action would be to repeal the August amendments, and that was captured in Ordinance 2022-03. There are roughly five topic areas I'd like to cover.
I can give them a rundown with what our what it was and what our recommendation is. Amplification is a more complicated one because it has other places in the ordinance that may need to be addressed and also deal with broader use of the public right-of-way. But we would suggest that for purposes of the public expression component, that amplification in and of itself no longer would trigger a permit, but that that amplification standard in public space be a 50-foot distance. So is it audible 50 feet away? That would be not require a permit. If it's audible further than 50 feet, then you're into something that is loud enough that a permit would be triggered. Amplification generally would be allowed from 6 a.m. to 9 p.m. in public spaces. If you want to go later or earlier than those times, you just need to get a permit that we would know that you're going outside of those times. And related to that is the time of event. So that really talks about, we had had a different standard in downtown versus citywide. We had a broad citywide after dark for, again, events that qualify for a permit or in terms of public expression. And we would suggest that instead of the after dark standard, that you have a up until 9 p.m., you use time of day, 9 p.m., and then again, a permit would be required. If you want to pursue some time after that, you'd go down a different path permit-wise, and then there'd be a prohibition time frame from 9 p.m. to 6 a.m., so you'd have those nighttime and early morning hours. And so you'd no longer have a Friday-Saturday downtown district differentiation. You'd have the same standard across the city. We would remove the requirement related to multiple events in a month. That would no longer trigger a permit. Let me make sure I'm capturing everything. There are a couple language elements from the previous ordinance that we wanted to clear up. There is a reference in section 16-527 that has the term observer in there. I believe the intent of that was to get at the actions of someone who might not be in the public expression or demonstration group, but it could be interpreted differently. We would just suggest the removal of that term to eliminate any confusion there. We would ask that additional language that we had in the repealed, what we're proposing be repealed, be added back in that just clarifies the interface with a already permitted special event. And that talks about additionally, no public gathering or expression event shall take place during a permitted special event in the permitted space. So you've already granted that permit, and that's their space for that time period of the permit. So you can't have a public expression permit come in and overlap with that. You just say we've already designated or granted a permit for that space. So that's really probably the five areas. I don't think I've missed anything that we would like your direction on. And if you want us to go item by item and get your feedback on those, our plan would be to take that in tonight, take your direction, and then draft a revised ordinance that repeals 2022-03 and then replaces language where you want to put language in, whether it's about the time of day, the amplification standard that is distance-based, and a couple of the language pieces that I talked about at the end.
And to me, after what you've described there, basically the two most important elements sound to be the amplification and the time, which I appreciate mm-hmm. each one of you addressing that. Does anybody have a problem with multiple events don't trigger an event? Okay, and then...
Don't trigger a permit.
Yeah, and then removing the observer.
Randy has a question. Randy does.
Do I have a problem with it? Yes. Multiple events?
Many multiple
she does.
Could we clarify for a moment? Just point of
let me finish, then I'll recognize Alderman.
But I need point of order on that. Because to me, when you're talking events, and the chief was talking about all these big events and everything, of course we have to have permits for them because they might have the streets closed and everything else. Well, what are we talking about here? I don't have a problem with multiple events if we've got
people, just 10 or 20 or 30 people meeting. But if we have an event, that's a whole different ballgame. So let's clarify the language here so I know what we're talking about. That's all I'm asking.
Sorry. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and go to Alderman Blanton and get her comment.
Well, I mean, just to stay consistent with my argument since we start talking about this, I mean, multiple events per month to me is, and I appreciate your words. Thank you so much, Chief Faulkner. That was great to hear from you. To me, it's making our public spaces be overused by one particular person. I think it's taking residents up in a public space that negates other people to enjoy it. I don't know what the trigger is. I'm not saying once a month or whatever, but I mean, multiple events per month. I mean, it, to me, it's not balanced. I mean, right. A lot of our public spaces that we rent out, we rent them out because there's mm-hmm. such a great demand for it. Mm-hmm. I'm learning that there's a bigger demand for our square and the sanctity of that and the use for all. It's a little bit more than it's been in the past. So that's right. Okay. If I'm the only voice of that, that's fine.
No, well, let me go back then.
Include that in your list.
I will include that in the response from each alderman. Permitted events takes precedence for the square.
Understood.
Everybody good with that?
Yep. Absolutely.
Okay. And remove the observer, the modification. Okay. Well, let's start out and go through the amplification with 50-foot distance. And Vice Mayor, would you start? Let's just go down the line. And if that's not what you like, say it. And we're trying to get some consensus.
I would never say what I didn't like. That's just not my
style. That's not your style, is it, Clyde?
No. Well, first off, let's go to the repealing of the existing ordinance. I do support that. I think we probably do need to repeal that. I think we need to go back and look at those issues, the five bullet points that you've got up there, and make sure that we're in agreement with that. We probably are not going to necessarily have a consistent agreement all the way through this, but I would like to see the amplification issues addressed, and I would like to see, I am concerned that one group can occupy one space at one time a week for 52 weeks out of the year. So I think we need to maybe address that, look at that. I don't think that's an infringement upon anybody's right to speak or their freedom of speech or whatever else. So look at that. But I do support the repealing of the original ordinance and replacing it.
Let me clarify. What we're proposing be repealed is the amendments that you approved in August. The base ordinance would still be there.
It's amendments.
Okay. Yeah. I just want to be
You're
clear.
You're fine.
Yep.
So you're okay with amplification at 50 feet?
Yep.
Time?
Time-wise, it's fine.
Okay. And you weighed in on the multiple events. Alderman Peterson.
I just want to say, whenever you're talking about that amplification, you're really talking about downtown.
We were talking about amplification in public spaces.
In public.
Citywide.
In public space.
In public space. What is the trigger that gets you to a permit? So if it's... If you can hear it 50 feet or less, mm-hmm. it does not trigger a permit. If it's longer than that, then we have gotten to something that's loud enough that it's now disrupting other people's use of the public space. So we're trying to hit the balance. We found from dealing with amplification in other settings that a distance requirement is much easier to understand and implement than decibel readings and other stuff. So that's just learning from other situations.
And then I also want to echo what has been brought up about having some people maybe feel like they can do something every single week for the entire year, which means that unless someone else comes in and gets a permit for something, then that they would be allowed to be there every single week. I think there is a concern that may be too much.
Time, are you good with the 6-8 of 9P?
I guess I'm okay.
Alderman Potts.
Yes, Mr. Mayor. When I look at the amplification piece, I'm not looking at Well, first, before I even do anything, Chief Faulkner, thank you. Appreciate you sharing those words. As you can see, I was actively taking notes during that, and I just really appreciate the direction that you've placed the importance of safety for our citizens, for our police officers, and the ripple effect of how these things can really impact the police department. So thank you for sharing all of that with us. When it comes to amplification, what I'm looking at is not necessarily the example that we're using right now in the square, and this is more of the question. Excuse me. If I'm reading this, if we're saying amplification, does that mean that as I go down Main Street and I'm if I'm walking to the theater, for example, and there's people on the corner right now, one person, a couple of people, and they have, hooked up an amp for their music, if they've hooked something up to sing from, if mm-hmm. they're doing those types of things on the corner, and I see head nods, so you guys.
Yeah, that's what we're talking about.
Right, and there's a section in the code already that prohibits this playing of musical instruments in the city right of way and also amplification, unless something else tells you you can do it. So what we're hoping to do after we get through this is to create some regulations around the playing of musical instruments in the city right of way. I think a lot of people, many people like having it played, but we also have an issue where, and we had forgotten about this, but when we talked to BNS, we have outdoor dining. And making sure that there's some space between the outdoor diners and someone playing music. So there's a couple of nuances we have to take into consideration with instruments, and we haven't gotten to that point yet to bring it to you, but we will. I've been researching and trying to see how other cities do it, but that is an issue.
All right. So for amplification, for me, I'm looking well beyond what we're talking about right here on the square.
Yeah, we're trying to have similar rule, same rule for everybody. And whether you're playing music as a performer or you're having a gathering or whatever it might be. So we're trying to have the same, because right now they're all technically prohibited without a permit, mm-hmm. and that dates back, I think, somewhere around 20 years or so or more. And so we're trying to update to what we experience today, what we, I think a lot of people like to have the music as part of the ambience of downtown, if it's not overwhelming other activities. So that's where we're trying to strike a balance on.
So my balance is I love the acoustic. I don't like the power connected to the instruments or to the devices, things like that. So I think that amplification should require a permit. For that very reason, because if we don't, then what we're going to find, in my opinion, is every other corner somebody's going to be set up, and they'll have that right to do that if we don't have this in place, if I'm hearing this correct.
So I'm is your direction that the 50-foot, you don't want the 50-foot standard, and you want to preserve that amplification always triggers a permit, or are you okay with the 50-foot standard?
It's two separate issues.
Yeah.
You've got the noise ordinance, and then for the
I think we need to talk about the...
It's the same standard applied to two different situations. Right. Both like somebody playing music on their own in the public right of way, and what also might be involved in triggering a permit otherwise. So it's really applying, trying to have the same standard for both situations.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
it is different, and we'll probably have to have it influence other places in our code, as Sean is referring. And we're looking at other ramifications, but if we can get a baseline of what you're comfortable with on how much amplification is too much and how we handle that.
Yeah, I think that any amplification does require a permit. Okay. And I'm looking more so at the musical instruments and people with singing, doing those things, and how that just carries down across all of our streets.
Time, 6, 8, and 9 P.
I'm okay with the time for now.
Multiple events?
Again, I think it's the same thing. You're looking at the same vendors or people who are playing their instruments on the street corners, things like that. I think if they're going to do that, then yeah, they should have a permit. I know that there's at least 3 or 4 different people who are set up. I think for now it would require a permit.
Alderman Hanson.
And thank you, Chief Faulkner, because this was the question I had of Eric and Shauna to see your approach and how this was affecting you and how you wanted us to deal with this best to protect our police officers and the community at large. So thank you for being here tonight. I am in support of repealing the ordinance additions that we made under 2203. Now, we still have the Title 16504 in place, and we also have a noise ordinance. And I'm okay with the 50 feet on the amplification. I think that's fair. And I do like the idea of creating something about musicians at a later date, because I think that's important to Middle Tennessee and Franklin and Nashville. I think that's an important component. We do need to address that and allow that, because it does add a nice ambiance when done correctly. Don't have a problem with the hours. We're good with the hours. I think that's fair. And if they want to go longer, they can get a permit. I do feel like we need a sign-up sheet that's not open for the public to view, but open for our police, our fire, our city staff to view who's registered. And it's something they would log on to create a login. So we would have their ID, we would have their names, their phone number, their email address, and they would sign up. But I don't believe that a multiple event should require a permit. But I do like the idea of a sign up so we know who's going to be there, when they'd be there, and how many people they think will maybe show up, just so we know, just so there's an awareness. And I know we have really good passive surveillance here, but that's not enough, and we can use that passive surveillance when we have the opportunity to know that somebody's going to be there. And we can use that to make sure they're staying in their confines of their hours and checking on them periodically. And again, when we have public calling concerned about what it is, I think that's a great idea. But I do think we need to repeal it, and I think we need to focus more on like our nuisance order ordinance and noise ordinance in general, with some disruptive situations we have in the community that are also a safety risk for us and for our police. So I do want to see us ramp that up, and I know I've addressed that before, but I think that this has really brought it to a head. And if we're going to apply it in one area, we've got to apply it across the board, and it's best for the whole community.
Thank you. Alderman Berger.
Yeah, I agree that we repeal this. Amplification, not all areas of town are the same. So I just don't know how you throw in 50 feet to satisfy everything. Now, if you're on a street corner at 4th and Main, 50 feet seems reasonable. If you're on the square, how much does 50 feet get you down at the end of the
sidewalk?
To the sidewalk. To the sidewalk.
So you got a diagram in the...
Yeah. Right. So I'm just rhetorically asking that question. So it gets you to the sidewalk. So I don't know about that, because the square is a large piece of property, and there's a large square, and I don't know, 50 feet doesn't do anything for me. If you're in a park, it doesn't really matter either, you know, a lot of times. So it's sort of a crapshoot in a way. 50 feet, you just throw up 50 feet, and, you know, what does that mean? So anyway, I don't think 50 feet, if we keep it at 50 feet, I don't think we need a permit for 50 feet. But if you're going to go over 50 feet, or, you know, go out there to the Mellow Mushroom area, or go down to 55 South and then go down to Merity's, that kind of thing, and then Puckett's may have some group with their door open and stuff. So I think there's a reservation on that. You know, so I could live with the 50 feet, but still I don't think everything's always the same.
Time.
The time is fine. I'm good with that, because after dark, I think it's harder to have for people's safety and everything. Multiple events, I don't have a problem with that. But honestly, we have to distinguish between multiple events and multiple gatherings of small groups. Again, we keep using these same words as events. Mm-hmm. Events are requiring permits. So, you know, I don't have a problem with, who is it? Marvin Young's out there on Friday mornings at 6:30. Jeff Daniels is out there on Saturdays at 6 o'clock. Does that mean they're going to be there every Saturday, every Friday, between now and 20 years from now? No. I don't know what their schedule is. I don't know what they're called to. And tomorrow, they may decide that God's called them to do something else, or another group comes out there. So honestly, I don't see that that's a problem with the multiple gatherings, and I'd rather call it gatherings of smaller numbers of people. Now, I don't care if somebody shows up at 10 people. I don't care if they show up at 30 people. The other day, I was out there, and I joined a prayer gathering. There must have been 50 people on there on Sunday afternoon at 4 o'clock. And I came down, my husband came down, and we walked across the street with them, and they met over here on the steps of City Hall, and they prayed, and it met a lot of people, and they were there for 40 minutes and gone. I don't think we regulate those things. That's a First Amendment right. People can come down in the square. They can gather with 2 people. They can gather with 10 or 20 people, or spontaneously they can gather with 100 people if they want. Mm-hmm. I don't want to get into regulating that. I think we have to be real careful. The only other thing is, you said something about a reservation, a sign-up sheet. I think it's really good if people are going to use our square and they're going to come and they want to be there. I don't care if it's for a prayer, it's a little yoga thing they want to do. Of course, that's an event, so they would have to have a permit for that because they're going to need something. We've already done that. But I think that we ought to have some place on the website where people can go in and sign up and say, hey, we're going to be there. That way, if somebody reserves the square or the park, then we can let them know so they can take a hike, not be there at that time. But I've been on that square, and I'll tell you, there's one more comment I want to make. They're not the only ones using that square. Friday night, or Saturday night, I guess it was, I was down there. And there was a lot of multiple people walking around the square. There was a small group, about 15 people. They were there for the purpose of prayer. They were there for maybe an hour, and they left. There were multiple people on the square, people coming in, walking around the square. They were free to go. They were free to go anywhere in that square they were. They were not being impeded by the people there. So when you say that they have accessed that square or accessed that park or something, that's a public place. Other people have the right to be in there, too, unless they've got a permit and they've reserved it. So we have to be careful what we're talking about here again. I don't want to get and make this so cumbersome that we have to write another ordinance and put more regulations in here. Again, there's no permit needed at that time. Right. I just think we have to keep that a little loose.
Alderman Baggett.
Thank you. Amplification, I'm good with as proposed. I do think it'll address this in my letter responses, but I think you've got 50 feet and then you've got, imagine there's a group in the middle of the square with amplification. Imagine there's someone at Mellow Mushroom playing and your 50 feet overlap. And so that's a challenge. I do think what I was saying earlier is we're dealing with kind of two different noise situations. One of them is with a special event or with this expression, which I think is different than the musician on the street, and I think that's probably better. Musicians on the street, I don't believe, need to come get a special event permit to set up like this. That all that stuff is going to be handled in our noise ordinance. So I think we need to really delineate between the two. We're talking about amplification for public expression events. In another couple months, you all can come and enjoy us talk about the noise ordinance or whenever it is. I think we have to deal with those separately because they do kind of conflate and confuse. So amplification, I'm good with that, 50 feet.
Time,
I'm good with time. I have no problem with multiple events per month. And because it's a public space and some of the freedoms I think we have. I kind of am confused a little bit. And with no disrespect, but I think a sign-up sheet is kind of like a permit. It kind of is. I mean, I think the only thing we're asking for in a permit is name, contacts, when you want to use it, and then it gets approved. So I feel like it's kind of the same thing. I would not want to have a permit for multiple events or a sign-up sheet. I think if you have a permit, you get precedence. So if I'm a group and I don't have a permit and I have 20 people, and that was another question, are we changing the 20 person?
Right now, that's was in the base ordinance. That's
gone.
Still there.
Okay, that's still there.
It's
fine.
And
it should be.
And again, it's it's not just that 20 people maybe get together. It is the fact that there is an organized event planned.
Absolutely.
I just want to be clear that that's, it's not just if there happen to be 20 people together, we're getting.
No, and I know that. I think if you've got, here's the thing. If I have 20 people, if I have 17 people, and I know I want to have a specific event, and I say, oh, I don't have to have a permit because I'm under 20, whatever. Well, if the group B has gone and they have 17 people, and they've gone through and gotten a permit, then they have precedence.
Right.
So I think that's important to note, because I think that too would kind of solve the amplification issue with multiple non-permitted amplifications in the same area. If you get the permit, you get the priority. But it's not required. And I think that would be generally agreeable. All the issues that we've had really don't exceed the 20 people, and if it does, I think, and I mentioned 40 people last time, I would be open to considering raising that 20 to 30. I mean, but I don't think we should have the permit multiple events per month. If you got nothing else to do, it's a public space. I'm not just going to regulate a public space because I don't want someone to use it when no one else is using it, but if someone else wants to use it and they get a permit, they get to use it, they have the priority. I don't think we can just say, you can only use our parks once a month. You can only use our square once a month. Like, I think this is kind of America still, and we just need to, like, I hope people don't use it every day the same way. You know, I hope that didn't happen. Maybe we have to address if it does. But once a week, it's no problem to me. I mean, we address the noise ordinance that gets it out of the residential areas, which sometimes that noise does extend to the residential areas, and the 50 feet helps. Last thing, the chief and I talked last time before this meeting. I said, Chief, how would your officers enforce this? And you know, it sounded like a good dose of common sense, where if the noise was disturbing the peace in proximity of the 50 feet, maybe it's 52, maybe it's 50, they're not going to have a measuring tape, but I trust our officers to administer the ordinance with common sense. And I think that's kind of what you said. But, and you can change those comments or make them more clear, but at some point we have to say our officers are gonna enforce this reasonably.
Alderman Brown.
All right. Yes to repealing. Two on the amplification. Because it's citywide and involving music and all that too, I'd actually been inclined to on weekends go a little bit later, but given that there's a permit that's triggered after 9, I'm okay with 6 to 9. I probably would have bumped to about 10. Keep in mind I'm in bed by 9 anyway, but that's all right. It just seems a little early to me on the weekends. But the 50-foot thing is hard for me. I think that's going to be what I hear at 50-foot and what somebody else hears at 50-foot are two different things. I think it's your point about Mellow Mushroom and the square. You got overlap. If you're sitting at Mellow Mushroom, and frankly, I think you're just going to have people who are just, depending on what is coming through the amplification, is going to trigger somebody to call and complain about the 50-foot. I just think it's going to be a really hard thing to manage, personally. I don't have an issue with the 50-foot. I just think it's going to be a very, very difficult thing to manage through. I agree with you. I trust our officers to have good common sense. I just think the 50-foot's a complicated measure. I don't have a better one. I'm just saying it seems complicated. Time event, no problem with the time. The multiple events, here I'm with you. I feel like this is, here's the hard part. What if somebody walks in here and throws on Monique's desk 52 permit applications for 52 events? They've now locked up this thing. We've actually created the very consequence that we were trying to avoid by having permit, because now they're locked in, they've got it for 52 days. If somebody wanted to be enterprising enough to do it, they do. Now, how do you remove that person because they did the due diligence to do the permit for a group that's relatively small? And now we're going to get into this conflict of, like, well, now who gets precedent, who doesn't? What if we suddenly need to do something as a city and somebody's already permitted that space? Can we come in and usurp their permit for our permit? It just seems like we're walking into some really difficult territory to try to implement here. I get the idea that somebody would essentially overtake our square as one group for a long period of time. I still want to believe in the good of people when it comes to that. I'm sorry, I do. I just feel like if people are out there praying, if somebody else wants to use that square for something, and we come and we say we have somebody else wants to use a square, I would sure hope somebody would move 50 feet down the road and let somebody use it. I don't know how you, that sounds like a nightmare trying to manage that. And the unintended consequences is literally stacks and stacks of permits for people trying to lock up spaces in our city over a long period of time. So yes to amplification, yes to time. I think we need more discussion on the multiple events. I don't think we found a solution yet on that one.
Alderman Blanton.
Amplification, I think 6 a.m. is crazy. I mean, we have rules about when trash can be picked up. We have rules about when construction can happen. I don't know where 6 a.m. came from, but, well, amplification at 6 a.m. is just, to me, inappropriate. So I think that should be a little bit later. 9 p.m. is fine. And then I already spoke on the multiple events per month.
You're okay with the 50 foot?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right.
She did her time.
I do have some people that want to speak, and as I said, I'm going to limit the time. I've got 5 minutes I'm going to allocate to speakers, so that means that these five speakers have less than 60 seconds each. So I'm going to ask you to line up and start immediately. Andrew Clark, Jeff Daniel, Ben Press Peterson, Jimmy Rice, and Marvin Young. Yes, sir, you've already into your time, so please go on.
I just want to explain to you, because I hear about the events and all this, if people come up there, we are respectful. If there's a permitted event, we don't come. We walk around the permitted event and pray. That's what we do. We don't put our speaker out there. We're not trying to bring attention to ourselves. We're trying to bring attention of God in this area, because this is what's important for us, praying for Franklin, praying for our aldermen and our leadership, and tearing down things that are tearing down God in our country. That's what we're here for. That's it. And we are very respectful. If anybody walks up there, we take tons of pictures of people. I swear, we take so many pictures, we should charge for it. But we don't, because we're trying to be respectful. People walk in, we make sure we're not in the pathways. We make sure people can get in. We make sure we're not standing in areas where they want to take a picture in front of the Christmas tree.
All right, your time's up, Ms. Daniel. Next.
I'm Andrew Clark. I would just like to read something. This is from Westlaw, and it's about the freedom of assembly. Congress shall make no law abridging the right of the people peaceably to assemble. As with other fundamental rights, there are limits. The police may break up any gathering that becomes violent or causes danger to public safety. Courts are reluctant, however, to limit the right to assemble based on the possibility of violence. When governments want to limit a gathering from taking place, they must prove that there is a clear and present danger, which is a very high standard. The right of the people to peacefully assemble for lawful purposes in a lawful manner without governmental interference is guaranteed by the First Amendment. Although the First Amendment limits congressional power only, the 14th Amendment safeguards the freedom of assembly from state interference. The freedom of assembly protects the rights to associate with others for a wide variety of political, educational, religious, and cultural pursuits. Freedom of assembly is closely allied with the freedom of speech and a right which, like free speech, lies at the foundation of free society. And that's from Shelton versus Tucker.
Thank you, Chief, Mr. Mayor, City Council members. My name is Ben Peterson. I'm from Minnesota, where we cut holes in the ice and go swimming in the middle of winter. And so I moved to Tennessee to gain a little more sense. And I just want to share that when we were looking for a home to live, we came and we visited Franklin. And we were walking through the square, and we heard the worship. And when we saw that there was a city that would stand for worship, when I came from a place where they protected the rights of those who were burning down their buildings over those that wanted to gather for worship, I knew this is where we wanted to live. So that's why I implore you to please continue to protect our rights, as this is a beacon for freedom in a city on a hill. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Jimmy Rice. I've walked these streets for going on six and a half decades, and Pastor Marvin behind me, and Jeff. I've been out there with them early in the morning and on Saturday nights, and being part of this community, you know, for so many years, it's been amazing to see what I've seen happen. 2 weeks ago, I was doing a Bible study by myself, and the Lord spoke to me and called me out. So I want to apologize because I don't know most of you, but we're all part of this community, building a better community for our children, children, children. And I have spoken some ill things about some of you, and so I'm sorry. I repent of that right now because I don't know you. So I'm called just to pray, and Lord, I've already asked the Lord when he called me out. It's like, okay, y'all have done some wrongs. Jeff's done some wrongs. I've been wrong. So, Lord, I thank you for your forgiveness and your grace and your mercy. Lord, I pray over each and every one of our city officials right here in Franklin. Lord, they're doing their best. I pray against the spirit of confusion. Lord, those that know you, Lord, pour out your spirit in them. They just whisper your name. Just give them wisdom beyond what this world has to offer. And those that don't know you, Lord, would you just pour out your mercy and your love on them as you did on the cross, Lord. Let them come to know the loving Father that you are. In Jesus' name, the King of Kings. Amen. Amen.
Greetings. I don't have much to say. Surprising, right? I will, however, say that I just want you to encourage you all. Marvin Young. Want to encourage you all to first continue to seek God. But I want to say that there's a point when Israel had just finished Passover. And after the Passover, they ate of the fruit of that land. After they ate of the fruit of that land, God ceased to bless them from heaven with manna. I'm only saying, let's not eat the fruit of the land. Let's continue to eat the manna. And we can only do that when we all are directed by the Holy Spirit. You all are in positions of leadership. We respect that. I respect each and every one of you. I've had the opportunity to sit down with 90% of you now. But I encourage you. I'm going to stop, man. I encourage you. Follow and trust God.
Thank you, Marvin. Okay, has staff got enough?
Our plan would be to bring this to you for consideration formally at the March 28th meeting. So if you want to have further discussion on the 14th, great. Let us know that at the work session. We need a little time to draft it, get it ready. Based on what we heard, there's some things you may still need to give us direction on. I believe this is a two-reading ordinance. So you'll have two readings on it. And we would propose to bring it to you March 28th for a first reading at that time and take any other guidance you want to provide at that point.
Item 5, City of Franklin Contract 2022-0212 with Friends of Franklin Parks for the lease of the historic Hayes House.
So we have representation from Friends of Franklin Parks and our Parks Director here to talk about a new arrangement related to the Hayes Home and our partner in restoring the Hayes Home.
Absolutely. So Tori Barnhill, Executive Director with Friends of Franklin Parks. We have a MOU with Friends of Franklin Parks, and we also have a 20-year lease with the multipurpose arena and the work that they've done over the last 10 years. What's before you this evening is a lease for the Hayes Home. They've been working in partnership with us for about 2 years to raise funds through the private sector. We will be working through the budget process as we'll be bringing utilities to the grounds to allow them to hook in as they do begin construction. But what's before you tonight is a lease for the Hayes Home for a 20-year lease. 20 with a 5-year additional. And then, Mayor, if I may go on to the next one as well. And then also is we currently have a lease with them, and we are amending that lease because it also brought in, had language in there for the historic Hayes Home. This separates the two as two leases together. And so I hope that clarification's within your packet. We're happy to answer any questions, or we're happy to leave.
No,
okay, I'm sorry.
I have a question for public clarification, not so much for me, but the public is probably confused about the relationship between the City of Franklin, Friends of Franklin Park, and the Hayes House in Harlandsdale. Can you give a brief overview, please?
Sure, absolutely. So we have multiple leases with nonprofits within our community. Friends of Franklin Parks is one of those. As we actually rent with Franklin Baseball. We do Battle of Franklin Trust. There's others, many other groups. This is a public-private partnership where we do projects together. We've done anywhere from small projects of ping pong at Pinkerton Park, but this is also a public-private partnership for them to raise funds for rehabilitation of our historic structures at Harlandsdale. So that is where they come into play. Friends of Franklin Parks has a lease agreement with us at Eastern Flank to rent offices. And as part of this, as they restore the Hayes Home, they will move those offices on site as their operations are there with the multi with the arena. Tori, is there anything else? You?
So we're just very fortunate and appreciative to work with Lisa Clayton and her team and Shahad and Law and Mayor and Alderman to move this project. We raised money a year and a half ago, 2 years ago. We've been going through many processes. We're ready to go. And if the lease is approved, then in 2 weeks we get to start, like, put the orange construction tape around the building and start moving dirt.
So to answer your question too, as we also work, they have been highly visible with the LEG's inclusive playground that we were doing at Southeast. Where we have found that we're different in Franklin is that public-private partnership. You're able to leverage what that community can do, and it's amazing when you all come together. And so under Tori's leadership, and we're excited about where we're going. And so I hope that answers your question. Thank you.
Okie doke. All right, next we're going to go to item number 7 is a special permit, event permit for Franklin Pride Festival, sponsored by Franklin Pride Tennessee at the park at Harlandsdale Farm on June the 3rd, 2023.
I'll kick this off. This is a special event permit. This is the proposed third year for this event at Harlandsdale. Let me give a little context on this, just to frame this here. We do an after-action report on every festival that is held that has a special event permit. And that's related to the organizer as well as our team. And there are a couple things that came out of the review from last year's Pride Festival at Harlandsdale, which was very, very well attended. And some city guidance, the guidelines were adjusted in terms of our permit based on board guidance, both in terms of updating that special event application to provide a more specific description of the event and specifically around the entertainment and activity of vendors. We also had a second item that was adjusted in that permit that provided specific emphasis on compliance with state law, and particularly how state law defines adult entertainment. So those were all integrated into this process. We had a sit down with the Pride Festival organizers, shared feedback that we got from the board and from the public. The mayor participated in at least one of those meetings as well. And all of that has fed into the application that is before you today. Again, this is for June 3rd, 2023. It's a daytime event at Harlandsdale. There are a couple specific elements that have been highlighted, and one in particular that we would welcome some guidance on. Specifically, the organizers have indicated there would be no drag show as a component of the event. That's specified in their application. There's also an offer made by the group to request a permit for the entire park, and that is done out of, my understanding, is out of consideration for a concern that was heard in the public about folks having a concern about coming upon this event without knowing in a park, in a park, public park setting. Staff has recognized that offer, but suggested it might be better served to maybe do some signage that makes the festival area more clearly defined, but preserves use in the park. Specifically, think of a northern area of the park. The dog park is really popular on a Saturday. So that's a big enough park that we ought to be able to
accommodate two different events, but also achieve the goal that the organizers have asked, which to make it clear where the Pride Festival is and where the other general park activity might take place. So that's a key component to what has been received and what the dialogue has been. Again, I believe that offer is made out of respect for concerns that were shared with them out of last year's event and just some general public question. But I think there's an openness to work together on that if there's a different path that may achieve the same goal of differentiating the event from general park use. Monique chairs our special event team. Lisa and her parks team host it as a park event or approved park event in the past. So I'll open up if they want to add anything to that in terms of framing the application that's before you. And we have representatives from the Franklin Pride applicant group organization here as well.
Yeah, that's what I was going to add, that the applicants are here if you guys have any specific questions for them. But yeah, we did meet with them several times last year to go over some issues that we'd heard about. And as Eric said, this is kind of what you see before you, some changes that they did make.
And I would just chime in that I requested to be part of that after action event and meet with the applicants. And at that time, my mailbox was pretty full. And I'd read every single one of them, responded to them, and I echoed the concerns of the community to the group. And I must say that they accepted those comments, and I think they've worked and tried to craft a festival that truly fits family friendly. And that was an emphasis that many people were concerned about. And I think they've tried to comply with that at this point in time. So I'll open it up for comments. Okay, we'll continue to move on then.
I've got a comment.
I didn't see your hand. Go ahead, Alderman Hanson.
Given the massive amount of emails that we did have last year, and then we also got an email back from the promoter of the event and the sponsor, and they were actually very proud of their event and thought it was successful and liked everything that was a component of it and stressed how great it was, despite possibly your meeting. Subsequently, from our event and others like it across the state, our General Assembly has gone on to pass, as you well know, House Bill number 9, which amends Title 7, Chapter 51. I personally cannot, on behalf of my constituents, take that chance again. And I know they came back and they said, okay, we won't do the drag show component. But something else has happened in the interim of June of last year in this application. And that was at our Franklin Kiwanis Christmas Parade. People associated with Franklin Pride worked our crowd. And when parents were not looking, they were slipping them brochures and magnets, and they were putting them in their candy bags. And I had numerous parents who don't even know each other reach out about that, and I know other aldermen did as well. To me, that's a very predatory type of behavior. It may not have been from the leadership, but it was for people who were associated with it, and they were advertising it in Harlandsdale, and they were doing it without talking to the parents, without making eye contact with the parents, and making sure that the parents were not looking. I cannot, based under state law, take that chance and that risk for our constituents again. I'd like a cooling off of a year before I can grant this activity in any of our public spaces, and the sheer fact that you are saying maybe we should take over the entire park to stop this is enough to drive the point home that it probably doesn't need to be on anything public. It needs to be indoors somewhere, regardless of what's going on. It's just, this is not the right setting for it, and I apologize.
Alderman Berger.
Well, in light of what happened last year, I would say that the board should consider postponing consideration for the application for this year, for 1 year, and give them, I would say that about any group that has caused so much angst in our community. I don't care what the group is, I don't care what you do, I don't care what, but if you cause all the angst that
came to be known as a cry out about public decency, community decency. In light of the issues we had last year in this particular group, whatever group it is, but this happened to be this one, they organized, they planned, they promoted, and they advertised specific activities and labeled them as family-friendly. And we know from the outcry of the community it was not family-friendly. And so I didn't think they were being transparent. They were not forthright with the city with what they had planned. But yet, I felt deceived that the community spoke loud then and clearly to the community decency standards at the time. And they shared this dismay. My constituents certainly did. And an outrage of behavior at our public parks in front of children of I don't care what persuasion of any type of persuasion a person is, that's not the issue here. The issue is what takes place in front of children and in our community. In addition, I would say that the community in general expressed grave concerns to me and a lot of us in activities that were performed or, again, taking place in a public place, violated our community general code of standard and conduct at the time. The community code of conduct and behavior in our public spaces has been maintained and enforced in this community since we were founded in 1799. The general community at large expects the city government to maintain order and peace in society and protect the rights and safety of all citizens, no matter who we are. So in light of, I believe, in the breach of community standards that this particular group of last year at Hollinsdale Farm, in light of unresolved issues at the community level, we have pending community decency ordinance that needs to be looked at, and pending bill at the state level that is coming to light here soon. And given the factors that we should, as a city government, we need to review and better identify and define in our ordinance our community decency standards and behaviors. I would recommend that we would delay or suspend the application for the use of our city parks or spaces to this particular group just for 1 year, and the group or any group that breaches a community decency standard at this time. And I'm speaking for my constituents who've overwhelmingly asked me to speak on this matter. Thank you.
Anybody else? Okay.
Sure.
Alderman Baggett.
You know, we live in a weird time, don't we? And I got all those emails too. And I just sat here and fought for the freedom of believers to worship on the square. And I mentioned the Constitution. I mentioned this was still America. And I have worked tremendously hard this last year with our city staff to amend this special event application with very specific language to keep from happening what happened last year. And quite frankly, folks, Blair Bitch, who performed last year, that was her name, it was absolutely abhorrent for a lot of us. And it shouldn't happen in our parks. Now, I'm pretty strong about that, okay? But at the same time, you live in America too. And you have, listen, my faith calls me to love my neighbor. I don't have to agree with you on everything. And that act may be one of those things we disagree on. The state law, man, I'll be honest with you, I advocated for the state law to be passed because of the situation that this put us in and put staff in, puts us all in kind of a weird situation. You want to rent a private place to do some of that stuff? This is America. But you have a right, in my opinion, to express your opinions. And, people might be mad at me for this. But the Constitution's pretty clear, and I just used it to let you guys come and pray and sing on the square as many times a month as you want. I was called to, you know, to love my neighbor, but I don't have to agree with you on everything I don't. I mean, that's all right. I can't, I mean, we have this state law. So many people worked hard to get that done. It's criminal to do, some would say, what happened last year in Harlansdale. No, we may disagree on that too. That's okay. But it's criminal to some of the things I've seen across the state. And that's can't we all agree on that? That is a really good. I'm sad that we're, you know, even in this position. I'd like to hear what the other aldermen think. A postponing of 1 year is, I'd like to see some more reasoning why this isn't comfortable for you for us to postpone this. I mean, I understand. Listen, we agree on a lot of things, but I think I'd like to hear more as to why the postponing is going to achieve more than we've already achieved with our state law and more than we've already achieved with our application changes. They have submitted and will submit a full detailed list of performers, which I think is what we added to our application. And by the way, we're going to do this for every single special event that comes through. Pilgrimage is going to have to submit all their acts because guess what? Now the state law applies to them too, right? So, I respect everybody, but postponing one more year, I'd like to hear more as to why, what the state has done and what we have done in the city, some of us, to make sure that we don't get surprised like we got surprised last year, doesn't happen again. I guess why would we wait another year? Because then you got to, and then why does this, the Constitution kind of not come into play, which I think it does. Just the pure expression of their of ideas.
Patrick, may I respond? Yeah. May I respond just quickly?
And then I'll go to Alderman quickly. Blanton. If you keep it very brief.
Yes, yeah, very brief. That, and I agree with everything you said here. I do. But at the same time, if anyone else, any other group, did something that was inappropriate, very inappropriate for our community standards, if we had a burlesque show of whatever, I don't care. Whatever it is. The other groups have come here, but they have not violated the community standards. And if they had, I would say, well, you need to take a year off, people, because you really gave us a black eye. You did us in with the community standards here. I don't care which group it is. If you had violated that, I would be calling the same thing for you. If you are a different group, or a Christian group, if you've done something inappropriate on the square, let's say, you're gone for a year. Just cool your pipes, take off a year. Because we've had to answer our constituents who have been pretty.
We go ahead and go to
Alderman. So that's my reasoning. That's you asked me, I'd Thank like you. To share that with you.
Yeah, I heard from a lot of people, but mine was differently because Eric and I got up on the stage and read the proclamation. I became a political campaign. Audible, which whatever, it's fine. I did not see the show that caused so much drama. That's probably not a good word, but upset, people getting upset. And I probably would have had a problem with that as well. I think the applicant has done everything they can to fix and remedy the wrong that was done and view it as that in order to be able to gather and celebrate their festival in our town. I saw more people there that felt so happy to see that they felt accepted, and to me it's all about loving people no matter their sexual preferences or whatever. I don't think a year is going to change anything to me. I think doing that makes the cavern get even deeper. I think us moving forward and saying you've put these things in play that this won't happen again, which to me was the biggest trigger of disdain in the whole situation, shows our working relationship to remedy things. I would go the opposite. I think a year break is just extending the inevitable. So.
Anybody else? I've got a few speaker cards. Alderman Fox.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
I received the same emails. I was taken back and how to address it. I'm really challenged because I agree with what Alderman Baggett was just saying. This is that freedom of expression and to celebrate oneself. I want to know, and I apologize, maybe it's here in the moment, but what are we doing to, if this were to move forward and it, if we were to move this event forward, what are we doing to ensure that, number one, that type of activity is never going to occur? And number two, who is going to be on site monitoring to have that? Because I agree, it's kind of like, you know, it happened. We didn't stop it.
As Alderman Baggett said, they will submit a full list of their performers before the event. And we also have officers that will be there on site. Probably at least four officers will be there.
It's handled the same way as we do every event. So if there is something in which, even though this particular, the law in which you speak of may not be in within at that time, we as a city will make sure that what has brought forth before you is carried out. And we would be the first to say, if we believe that someone needs to be or an event needs to be canceled, then there are provisions to do that. And there's provisions to stop an event immediately.
So you've got, the way we always work it is you've got event staff from the city on site. It's a mix of public safety,
public works,
administration. And whenever there's an issue with the event, we can work right back through the organizer because it's their event, they've got the permit, and they're responsible for it. So we've had other situations, they may not all be exactly like this, but we've worked back through and addressed the issue with the organizer and address it and rectify it right there. And that can take whatever form is needed to address the circumstance.
We do it from athletic events of escorting people out to pilgrimage to anything that we may have. So we will handle it the exact same way. We are very consistent with that.
We have a very good special events team that has worked events for years and years and have a lot of insight on how to manage it. And that is something I think event organizers have benefited from and relied on to help make the events work. But it also is a way that we make sure it stays within the parameters of the agreement.
I see that they've offered to rent the entire park, but my question there was someone unexpectedly might happen upon the park during their festival. And I thought, well, this is to address that they offered that to address that concern. But what would be the concern? If it's family friendly and people would happen upon an event, there shouldn't be any problem with that.
I don't know
why you would rent the parks so people wouldn't happen upon your event if it's called family friendly. I don't think that's a problem. That's a huge park, so I could not support at all having the entire park shut down.
Yeah, I think it was just out of respect for what we heard from some in the public that were just concerned about a Pride event generally and that it's in the park and if they didn't want to come upon it without knowing, and it was just to try to differentiate the event. Well, we heard concerns from people just about not just the family friendly question, but an event of that nature generally. And I think that was out of response to that as well. So I think it's an added protection to that. I think we're not necessarily advocating for that. I think it was offered in a way to try to be responsive to a concern they heard from the public. And so what we've suggested as an alternative is maybe just some clearer differentiation within the park, but you still can allow the rest of the operations in the park, such as the dog park and other things like that, continue to operate. I think there's a way to do both.
I don't think
it's fair to interpret it as anything other than them trying to be responsive to concerns we heard from the public a year ago.
Well, I thought that sounded like we were digging ourselves in a hole there, because if it's family friendly, it shouldn't matter. You should be able to be in a park.
Well, then you don't have to require them. They're offering it to you. They're not, you know what I mean? They're offering it as an option, not necessarily, the way I understand it, not necessarily requiring it. They're just saying, this might help. We'd be willing to do it if you want us to.
I think, Matt, one more thing real quick. Really sure. Quick.
And while you're saying one Please. More thing, I'm going to ask Andrew Clark and Clayton Klutz to come up and be prepared for a one-minute comment.
I think what we have is a concern. We do. We all feel, well, I'll speak for those that have spoken, like a little bit of some apprehension because we were kind of sideswiped with some content that a lot of people emailed. I mean, not just emailed, called. We got on the news, you know, and it wasn't just like, oh, there's the few. And so I think maybe understanding the controls a little bit better, like if I can understand how we are going to enforce it. I know that our staff is fantastic, but quite frankly, it's a tough position. And I can see where someone last year might have been like, oh my, and then didn't do anything. And then, so how I think I would like to get a little bit better idea of kind of with this new state law that I think will be enforced by then is for us to feel comfortable with, again, it's kind of like this shock from the last year, and we don't want to relive that again. And how are we going to make sure that it is enforced in a way that we feel comfortable pre-approving an event, right? And I think that's the disconnect, is that there's not enough, or there's a few people who don't feel comfortable.
In this group, too.
Yeah, and the pre-approval with last year, where we approved it, and everything on the app was fine, and then we got that. How is this going to be different? And I think we could probably have, how is this going to be different than last year?
This is different because you have an event application that's very specific about that issue.
It is.
You did not have that a year ago. So where there may have been confusion or uncertainty, there is now.
Right.
And so we ask for everybody who gives us a special event. It's question number 7 on the application, or eight. It says specify the nature of entertainment and of vendors and those sorts of things. So we ask for that to the extent they're able to. And these events, all of them, are somewhat fluid. And they have to have their application in 90 plus days from the event. So we know some of that evolves. And so we're just asking, what do you know now? And we're asking to just get updated as that gets closer to the event so that we know what's going on and just have the best information we can. So that's one element, is just more knowledge and more understanding and a specific description of what's going to happen at the event, or in this case, also what's not going to happen at the event. And then we have accountability right back to the organizer on that basis. And that's what our team will be using to have in place that we would not have had and did not have in place a year ago.
Can you get them to refine that list really, really well, get that list and then have us review that and then have some more discussion? Or
I'm glad to provide that to you. I think you want to be careful to not get into the business where you're approving everybody who performs at every special event in the city of Franklin.
I agree, but
so it's a balancing of that.
The comments, and yeah. I agree, but you've heard the comments, and I think that right. We all might feel better with that.
Again, yeah, we can provide that to you, but I are you asking to approve it, or you just want it as informational?
I think people would want to know that full list.
This group has a right to apply. They have a right to be there.
Right.
I am not debating that at all. This is America. You need to be able to apply and be approved. But we need to make sure that the big elephant in the room that we were talking about last year doesn't happen again. And I know we have some stopgaps for that. Mm-hmm. We have some safeguards for that now, too. So thank you.
All right, Mr. Clark, you have 1 minute.
I think what we're talking about here is an age restriction. Calling it family friendly is just an opinion. Matt or Patrick, I can say I love you, and it's my job to love you, but if I throw a Halloween party and your wife shows up in risque lingerie and you're wearing a G-string, I'll probably ask you to leave, okay? And I'm not assuming that you would, but I'm talking about the things that are normalized at these types of events, what we saw on video going on. Whether that person is a scheduled person or whether it's just people showing up and flaunting their sexual preferences and taking things that we may call normal in a bedroom, whether it's a couple of people or however you like to conduct your sexual life, doing it in public and doing it in front of children normalizes what children don't even begin to understand. They have not had any experiences as mature sexual human beings. They don't understand what's going on with this. And to call it family friendly is utterly ridiculous. Even our movies have age restrictions to them. So you've got to look at this differently and quit dancing around this. We've got to love everybody, and everybody has the right. Yes, everybody has the right, but there are norms.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Clayton Klutz, and I'm president of Franklin Pride. We've had over 5,000 people in attendance for the last 2 years, and to see all the smiling faces of people who have their families, those are people who live here in our community and are part of our community. And to hear the proclamation from the city read from the stage was one of the most meaningful and moving things I've ever experienced in my life. To hear the words out loud, you're part of this community and you're welcome here. That's why we don't want to have a private venue with age restrictions. This is very much a family event for a lot of our families here in the community, and we just want it to be in a most accessible place.
Did it slip through, or was, who knew about it ahead of time? When did it not get approved or approved or whatever? Because I'd like to understand how that got there. If we're advertising a family-friendly event, how that got into that particular, did somebody just show up?
We didn't, and we haven't previously gotten a list of performers, and so we didn't get that last year, right? We don't for anybody.
We just hadn't, and now we've asked for more right. specificity in the event application yeah. since then.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so any type of concert that we've ever had in the park system, you only deal with the organizer. So if they had a special guest, pilgrimage, for example, there are a lot of different people that come out, or a lot of different artists. We do not ask for those lists.
So your event organizer would have had to have approved this particular act, right?
They would have approved the act. I don't know if they would have approved a specific performance, but yes, they would have approved the act.
Correct. Mm-hmm. So if it's removed, then we take that serious that they are not going to do that anymore.
So how long, and I'm just asking, how long would do you think it would take you to shut down an event with 2,500 people in there?
Well, in my past, as parks director in Franklin, I have shut down
the pilgrimage.
We shut it down pretty quick, within a few minutes. Any athletic tournament, we've had people go to blows, we call it really quickly. It doesn't take a lot to shut one down. You cannot keep people from speaking.
It took a lot to shut that pilgrimage down.
It did, and it was a very hard decision. But it was a decision.
But once the decision was made, it happened pretty quickly. Let me tell you, as the person who made that decision. Once we made it, we went and we took care of it. And we were shut down.
But you were well over an hour before you got everybody out on that pilgrimage.
Well, you got to get 20,000 people out of a venue. That's a little different than stopping the event. You know, evacuating an event is a different animal than making the decision and stopping something, in that case, because of the threat of severe weather.
So evacuating and stopping.
Yeah. They are different things.
I would consider them pretty doggone. They might be double first cousins.
They are very different.
Okay.
Because you can stop something, but if you got a large number of people there, and in this case, is the weather drove it, you got to get 20,000 people out. That takes time. Pulling the plug and saying you're not performing anymore because there's threatening weather, that was pretty quick. They are very different activities.
All right, y'all have broken every rule that I like, and that is to finish the work session at 7 o'clock, and I'm going to start working on making sure we get done at 7. Y'all are setting some records. Did you want to make a comment?
Yes, sir, if you don't mind. I appreciate very much so the protections for our families. I appreciate the comments that were made. I agree. But I got to tell you, and I've laid my faith out in this room so many times, the thought of asking a group to postpone an event after they've offered the protections of the things that are concerning to us, after state law has been enacted, after we've got this rigorous process, to suggest that it's not important to love people, to fight for the rights of one group and not another, I got to be honest with you, I don't think we're doing it right in the eyes of the Lord, and I don't think we're doing it right in the eyes of the values of this community. And maybe I don't really understand the values of this community like I thought I did, but man, I'm a part of a group that meets with different faiths and pray together. I'm a part of a group that embraces different races. I'm a part of a group that loves on people. I don't understand why we would, with all the protections in mind, I did not like what happened last year. There's no doubt about it. I was as fired up as anybody else. But with all of the protections in place, with all of the due diligence, that we wouldn't give a group a chance to meet together, 5,000 people who want to be together and demonstrate the love of our community on them, to allow them to do that, again, with the protections in place that we don't have in a repeat event. Folks, I think we're doing it wrong. I don't think that's what the Lord calls us to do. And I think we need to check our hearts on that one.
Item 8 is an ordinance 2022-45 to amend Title 16, Chapter 14, Small Wireless Facilities in the Public Right-of-Ways with Appendix A, Comprehensive Fees and Penalties.
We'll put this into overdrive. Item 8 is a pretty straightforward allowance in state law that allows us to update some fees related to small cells, wireless facilities. This would allow us to collect a little more for the impact on our right-of-way. So it seems pretty straightforward, and the state's already allowed it. We just need to update it to reflect it. You do okay?
Well done. Good job. Item 9 is an ordinance 2022-49 to amend Title 8, Chapter 2, Section 202 of the Franklin Municipal Code relative to the definition of premises for consumption of beer.
I'll also be fast. Those of you on the beer board have already heard this. You guys probably remember that the factory came in and they asked for a special permit that would allow them to sell alcohol and beer inside their facility from their own restaurant beer areas, and you could take it within their own areas, including the theaters. What this section would do would create what's called combination premises permit. And so like Mojo's Taco and the factory would enter into a lease agreement that would allow people to go to, say you really want a margarita and you're waiting on a show or you're waiting on something else, you can go to Mojo's, get the drink, walk around with it, but the rules are it has to be in the lease, and then the cup has to have the logo Mojo's as you walk around. There's some rules about that. The state's already allowing it for liquor. This would just allow it for beer. Factory's really interested in it, but it could also be used maybe at the mall. Like someone could be at Cheesecake Factory. You've got an hour wait. You go ahead and get a drink. And if the mall's interested in doing this, you could walk around with your alcohol.
And the state law permits this. This is really consistent with what's provided for already in state law.
Okay, we're going to be back here in 10 minutes, and maybe we'll consider an ordinance to allow us to have a margarita.